أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. We continue our theme دروس الحياة من قصص الأنبياء في كتاب الله. And we heard the end of the recitation of Surah Kahf and of course Surah Maryam and other parts of the Quran, Surah Anbiya. And the theme of Surah Kahf, which we have heard, revolves around the most common trials faced by the faithful people. And Allah proposes certain solutions to those trials and tribulations. The surah in fact contains four stories that unveil profound wisdom and convey tremendous lessons. The first story is the story of the people of the cave, Ashabul Kahf, and it is a story pertaining to the trial of faith. It centers on a group of believing young people, we do not know exactly how many they were, who lived around the 3rd century of the Christian era in a society of corruption led by a tyrannical ruler. Some believe it could have been King Decius at the time, the Roman king, wherein these young people found persecution prevalent and they were persecuted themselves because of their beliefs. Allah records how these youth distanced themselves from the corruption, stood up in protest, firm upon their convictions. This is one of the most common trials that people of faith and people of conviction often face. Trials of maltreatment due to your beliefs, which can lead to persecution of people because of their faith, which can lead to torture and even sometimes to death. The lesson we learn from the Ashabul Kahf, the youth of the cave, is that the quality of faith is not always dependent upon age. These were young people. Number two, that young people too can be steadfast in their faith. And number three, we learn that standing up for principle, bonding together, enduring challenges as comrades, and principled patient perseverance helps in overcoming the challenges posed by a corrupt and an oppressive system. The second trial in Surah Al-Kahf pertains to the trial of wealth, depicted in the story of Sahibul Jannatain, a person, an unnamed man, who possessed two gardens. And Allah blessed the man with much wealth, yet all of this wealth only led him to arrogance and to haughtiness. He belittled his much poorer friend who advised him, admonished him, and saying, "Be thankful to Allah for what you have. So many people don't have what you have." He belittled the person. And when the rich man's crops failed, his income became depleted, and his wealth was lost, then he was in utter desperation. We learn from this story that if obtaining wealth at all costs and by any means becomes the primary goal in life, then wealth can easily lead to arrogance, to pride, to corruption, and to the undermining of other people. Wealth, of course, has its place, but it's not life in itself. Wealth may provide the means for survival, but it is not the purpose of our living. We learn that when wealth is made available, we must consider that wealth as an amana, as a trust from Allah, and spend it in a way that makes the world a better place for as many people as possible. The third unique story is the story of Qissa ma'a Musa ma'al Khidr, of Musa alayhi salam, and revolves around Musa alayhi salam and a teacher who is not named in the Quran, whom we believe from prophetic tradition refers to Khidr. And it pertains to the trial of knowledge. And the lesson derived from this story, which is detailed of Musa and his teacher, is that Musa alayhi salam is one of the ulul azm in the Quran, among the greatest and mightiest of the messengers of Allah. And he goes and learns from an unnamed sage who teaches him the wisdom of things that may not be apparent at first glance. Not the basic fundamental layer, but the deeper layer of things. Musa debates with him through logic, and he responds to Musa with deeper wisdom. So, what we learn from this, if a prophet who receives divine guidance from Allah himself is prepared to go and learn from someone, then nothing should prevent us to learn from those who are more knowledgeable than us in a particular field. Two, recognize that there exists a variety of perceptions, differing depths of knowledge, and varying levels of understanding. And three, realize the importance of humility as well as patience in pursuing that knowledge. The fourth story pertains to the trial of power, illustrated in the Qissa of Dhul-Qarnayn, the story of Dhul-Qarnayn. Historical information at our disposal is not sufficient to make any categorical assertion about the exact identification of who Dhul-Qarnayn really was. Dhul-Qarnayn was an everyday mortal, entrusted with tremendous power and an incredible capacity. And this incredible capacity and tremendous power brought with it extraordinary responsibility. If we reflect on the incidences which are mentioned in the surah, in the Quran, from the life of Dhul-Qarnayn, we learn essential lessons in leadership. An effective leader is an empathic leader who's always connected to the people. Leaders are only efficient when they have an efficient strategic plan and work through a team of dedicated followers. And three, true leaders serve the interests of the people by addressing the needs of the people, as the saying goes in Arabic, Sayyidul Qawm Khadimun. Now, from all of these stories, we learned lessons. But what's the general lesson of all the four stories? Who were the people of the cave and how many were they? Were they five? Were they six? The Quran deliberately does not tell us. Why? Because it does not matter. Who exactly is the owner of the two gardens? No one really knows. Who exactly was the person we assume to be Khidr? Question mark. And who precisely is Dhul-Qarnayn? No definite answers. You see, it really does not matter so much as to who any of these were in order to derive the message and the narratives have to offer. However, so significant were the lessons of each of these and the trials that they faced that Allah documents their story in Surah Kahf as part of divine revelation, but without mentioning their names. The lesson in that, there's no limitation to our innate potential and no barriers to our inherent goodness if we sincerely do what needs to be done without bothering who gets the credit. Nonetheless, the focus here is not so much on the personalities, the focus is rather on the lessons we derive from their lived experiences through different periods of history. Four stories highlighting four trials, major trials in people's lives. Trial of faith, trial of wealth, trial of knowledge, trial of power. Trials that we still face today. So we realize that throughout history, trials are many, life is short, and that we as people should do the best we can with what we have from where we are, ever cognizant of the fact that eventually we will be held individually accountable by Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.